Good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis session by Shankar IAS Academy, dated 12th July 2021. The list of news articles for today's discussion is given for your reference along with the page numbers in various editions of the newspaper. With this, now let us move on to the news articles discussion. Now let us begin our news articles discussion with this news article, Cooperative Spirit. As we know, the Union Government had recently created the Ministry of Cooperation. And for the time being, the ministry will be headed by the Union Home Minister. See, this is aimed at realizing the vision of Sakar Se Samriddhi, meaning prosperity through cooperation. In this context, let us discuss this news article regarding how the ministry shall function. The syllabus covered under this discussion is given for your reference. As we know, in India, a cooperative-based economic development model is very relevant, where each member works with the spirit of responsibility. So what exactly is a cooperative society? A cooperative society is a voluntary association of individuals having common needs who join hands for achievement of the common economic interest. Its aim is to serve the interest of poorer section of society through the principle of self-help and mutual help. In short, the main objective is to provide support to the members with the principle of self-help and mutual help. See, cooperative society can be formed as per the provisions of Cooperative Societies Act 1912. This act is a central act. But however, cooperative society is a state subject under entry 32 of list 2 of 7th schedule to the constitution. So, though the act is still in force, it has specifically repealed in almost all the states, and those states which have repealed have their own Cooperative Societies Act. And another important legislation here that can be mentioned is the Multiple State Cooperative Societies Act, which was passed in the year 2002. Now coming to the Ministry of Cooperation, see, this ministry is expected to provide a separate administrative, legal and policy framework for strengthening the cooperative movement in the country. It will also help to deepen cooperatives as a true people-based movement reaching up to the grassroots level. Also, it will streamline process for ease of doing business for cooperatives and enable development of multi-state cooperatives. Now, let us see the structure and statistics, few important statistics of cooperative societies in India. See, the country has more than 1.94 lakh cooperative dairy sectors and 330 cooperative sugar mill operations. The cooperative sugar mill here accounts for almost 35% of sugar produced in the country. In case of the banking and finance, cooperative institutions are spread across rural and urban areas. In several states like Kerala, cooperatives have grown into huge level where they even run IT parks and medical colleges. Hence, in the future, with adequate support, they might also expand into sectors such as insurance. If you see, the village level primary agriculture credit societies, farmers association, are said to be the best examples of grassroots level credit flow. These societies anticipate the credit demand of a village and make the demand to the district central cooperatives bank. Here, note that the state cooperative bank sits at the apex of rural cooperative lending structure. Given that the primary agriculture credit societies are a collective of farmers, they have much more bargaining powers than an individual farmer pleading his case at a commercial bank. But what necessitated the formation of new ministry? As we know, the cooperative structure flourished only in handful of states like Maharashtra, Gujarat, Karnataka and few others to be mentioned. With a new ministry, the cooperative movement would get the required financial and legal power needed to penetrate into other states also. But there is criticisms against this move, mentioning that the creation of new ministry is an assault on federalism and the real aim of the party in power is to control cooperatives in the states of Maharashtra and Gujarat. For example, if you take Maharashtra, it is said that the leaders of NCP and Congress control most of the cooperatives, including the sugar mill. So to conclude, we can say that the formation of a separate ministry for cooperatives shall bring in transparency and efficiency in the cooperative sector. Also, it shall act as a catalyst to strengthen the cooperative sector and not just being a command authority controlling the entire sector. With this, we have come to the end of this topic discussion. Now let us move on to the next news article. Moving to the next news article, tapping on the potential of the youth. This open editorial article discusses the importance of harnessing the potential of demographic dividend of our country and the obstacles in it. The author also provides suggestions to overcome these obstacles. So today, let us focus on these aspects. The syllabus covered under this news discussion is given here for your reference. First, let us understand the definition of demographic dividend. See, when the working age population is growing faster than other age groups, then these conditions can yield an opportunity for accelerated economic growth, which is known as the demographic dividend. In other words, demographic dividend is the economic growth potential that can result from the shift in a population's age structure, and this happens mainly when the share of working age population is larger than the non-working age share of the population. According to the United Nations, the working age population is between the age of 25 to 64, and the non-working age population is below the age of 14 and 65 years and older. The advantage of demographic dividend is that it helps in expanding the per capita productivity of economies. So if we take India, we have an advantage of demographic dividend like no other country in the world. It is because, as per the UNESCO's data, India has one of the youngest population in the world. Here we are talking about the youth population. See, as per the National Youth Policy 2014, youth is defined as a person in the age group of 15 to 29 years. And why this portion of population is important? See, even though we have a good working age population, it is the youth population which decides whether we will be able to reap socio-economic advantages. Also, it is because youths are enthusiastic, vibrant, innovative, and dynamic in nature, which makes them the most important sections of the population. In addition, youths show strong passion, motivation, and willpower, which will make them the most valuable human resource for fostering economic, cultural, and political developments of a nation. This is why a country's ability and the potential for growth is determined by the size of its youth population. So it is important to evaluate the youth in the working age group. Coming to India, at present, it has more than 60% of its total youth population in the working age group. Especially, 35% of India's population is between the age group 15 to 29 years. And over 60 crore people, that is almost 1 in 2 Indians, are under the age of 25. Hence, India's population is among the youngest in the aging world. See, based on these data, we can also say that currently India has a positive demographic dividend, but it is not going to last forever. According to author, several researchers, including a UNDP report, has indicated that population stabilization will be achieved earlier than the expected target. Population stabilization is also called the stage of zero population growth. That is, it is the stage when the size of population remains unchanged. Generally, country-level population stabilization occurs when the birth plus in-migration equals death plus out-migration. And as per the national population policy, India's long-term objective is to achieve a stable population by 2045. But as per the researchers, this will happen 12 years earlier than the targeted year. So this demands leveraging of India's demographic dividend to be sooner. But even though population stabilization has many benefits, it will come with certain disadvantages. One is that the population will have fewer young people supporting huge number of elders. This implies a need for fewer schools but a greater demand for the assisted living support system. That means even though young people would get more employment opportunities, higher wages, cheaper houses, they would also have to bear cost of geriatric care. Additionally, this would mean decline in the young labor force and creative manpower, which will ultimately degenerate creativity, innovation, and business growth in the following decades. And this is not good for the growth of an economy. That is why author stresses the need to safeguard young people's well-being so that existing positive demographic dividend could sway development to our advantage. Here, safeguarding would mean adolescents and the youth to be healthy and well-educated. But there are many hurdles in this. First, let us discuss the issue in education process. First and foremost is the pandemic. It has abruptly halted the education of children by school's closure because not many have the resource to make use of digital education. Secondly, pandemic has majorly affected one gender, that is female, who constitute half of the students' population. Around 15.8 crore female students are affected by pandemic, which led to their dropout from schools. Worrying factor is, even if everything normalizes, most of these female students are unlikely to go back to school. One of the major reasons for this is the early marriage of girl child, that is the child marriage. Already, India has registered an alarming rise of child marriages during the pandemic. Third issue is the underfunded education system in our country. According to author, the World Bank data suggests that in India, public expenditure on education constituted just 4.4% of GDP in 2019 and only 3.4% of GDP in the year 2020. But if you take the data in the economic survey, these figures are much more worrying, where only 2.8% of GDP was spent to education in the year 2018 to 2019, whereas it was 3% of GDP in the year 2019 to 2020. Also, the budget estimate for the year 2020 to 2021 is also just 3.5% of GDP. Fourthly, researchers also show that quality of education measures is also poor, such as by highlighting the poor student-teacher ratio. So with this, let us discuss the issues in health of young population. Firstly, school closures also have a serious impact on mental well-being of children. According to a survey by International Labour Organization, adolescents are suffering more. Around 17% of adolescents are likely to be suffering from anxiety and depression. The second issue is safeguarding children from the COVID infections. And thirdly, the access to health schemes have been impacted, especially those ones which benefit adolescent girls. For example, we have the menstrual hygiene scheme, which is under the Adolescence Reproductive and Sexual Health component of National Health Mission. Know that under this scheme, sanitary napkins are distributed to adolescent girls in the age group of 10 to 19 years residing in rural areas. Now, the school closures have impacted access to such schemes. So, what has to be done to solve these issues? First is regarding the school closures. Since school closures have affected the lives and mental health of children, the author suggests prioritized vaccination of teachers and school support staffs. Along with this, reopening of schools in a phased manner based on local COVID-19 transmission rate is essential. With this, the mix of online and offline education is another suggestion. Second suggestion is regarding a holistic solution through collaborative actions by key ministries, government agencies, and civil society. This collaborative action has proven successful earlier. Therefore, such an approach will enable fabricating better solutions to the above issues. So with this, we have come to the end of this topic discussion. In this, we saw about the facts related to demographic dividend, the issues surrounding the health and well-being of adolescent children, especially the adolescent girls. Alongside, we also saw the solutions to the problems. Keeping this in mind, let us move on to the next topic. Moving to the next topic, let us take up this news article. Gehlot sworn in as Karnataka governor. See, the former union minister Thawar Chand Gehlot took oath as the 19th governor of Karnataka on Sunday. In this context, we shall know about governor in our discussion. See, the state executive organ consists of governor and the council of ministers with chief minister as its head. But the executive power of the state is vested in governor under Article 154. That is the reason why we call governor as the head of the state, whereas the chief minister as the head of the government. See, the governor of a state is appointed by the president generally for a term of 5 years, but the tenure finds no mention in the constitution. And remember that the governor holds office during the pleasure of the president. Now, if you see the eligibility, only Indian citizens are eligible for the appointment to the office of governor, and he or she should be above 35 years of age for appointment to this office. And remember, Council of Ministers, with Chief Minister as head, aids and advises governor in exercise of his or her function. But there are certain functions which are possibly be exercised by the governor in his or her discretion, such as sending reports to the president under Article 356, reserving certain bills for the consideration of president, which is under Article 254, subclause 2. Along with it, governor plays an important role in appointment of chief minister of a state. Besides this, the governor also sends a report to president about the failure of constitutional machinery in a state, where the governor exercises their own judgment. And if you see, sometimes governor has also special functions. Take Nagaland. Here, governor has a special responsibility under Article 371A of the Constitution with respect to law and order. Similarly, in respect of Arunachal Pradesh, governor has special responsibility under Article 371H of the Constitution with respect to the law and order. Here, governor shall, after consulting the Council of Ministers, exercise his or her individual judgment. See, these are, however, temporary provisions, where if president, on the receipt of a report from governor, feels that these provisions no longer necessary, the president may suspend these special responsibilities that were given to the governor. Likewise, in the 6th schedule, which applies to the tribal areas of Assam, Meghalaya, Tripura and Mizoram, discretionary power are given to governor. This discretionary power pertains to matter relating to sharing of royalties between district councils and state government, vesting additional discretionary power in governors. Alongside this, 6th schedule vests additional discretionary powers in governor of Mizoram and Tripura in almost all their functions since December 1998. In Sikkim also, governor has been given special responsibility for peace, social and economic advancement of different sections of the population. Apart from that, most functions by the governor are performed on the advice of chief minister and the council of ministers. It includes summoning and proroguing the session of the state legislature, promulgation of ordinance, giving assent to the bills, and appointment of council of ministers are other functions that governor exercises on the advice of chief minister and council of ministers. Besides, the governor is the appointing authority in respect of the following authorities. Again, this is based on the aid and advice of the Council of Ministers. It includes appointments of Advocate General, Lokayukta, State Election Commissioners, the Chairman and Members of Human Rights Commission, the Chairman and Members of Public Service Commission, finally, the State Chief Information Commissioner and Members of Information Commission. These are few functions and the role of governor that we have discussed now. With this, we have come to the end of this topic. Now, let us move to the next topic. Moving to this news article, pressure fuse points to Pakistani hand. See, in recent times, we saw a news that drones are being used to carry out cross-border terrorist attacks. On the Indian Air Force in Jammu region. In that context, let us know more about drones from preliminary point of view. See, a drone is also known as unmanned aerial vehicle or unmanned aircraft system. It is a flying robot that is navigated from the ground using a GPS tracking system. But some drones can also fly autonomously through a software-controlled flight plan. That is, no remote real-time operation is needed. And see, drones have the capability of reaching the most secluded areas with little or no manpower in the least amount of effort, time and energy. And this is one of the biggest reasons why they are being adopted worldwide, especially in military, commercial, personal and future technology sectors. See, drones are equipped with the different state-of-the-art technology such as infrared cameras, GPS and laser. and they are controlled by remote ground control systems. So, an unmanned aerial vehicle system or a drone has two parts, the drone itself and the control system. The first part is regarding the drone and the second is the control system. The nose of the unmanned aerial vehicle is where all the sensors and navigational systems are present. The rest of the body is full of drone technology systems since there is no space required to accommodate humans. Remember, the engineering materials employed in drones are very lightweight and are highly complex composites. They are also designed to absorb vibrations which decrease the sound produced. Now let us see in brief about their application in various fields. First comes the attack drones. These drones are used only by the military and is equipped with weapons which can be used for controlled airstrikes. This is the case with the recent terror attack. Next is the delivery drones. These drones are being employed as a new way of delivering items to the customers and are used by some big shipping companies such as Amazon. They also used to deliver medicines in an epidemic areas where manual delivery risks human contact. Next is the surveillance drones. These drones are equipped with cameras and are used across a number of industries such as law enforcement, sports, forestry and farming. Due to their greater efficiency, agricultural drones are used for carrying out field surveys, estimating crop yields and also for keeping tracks of livestock. Apart from these, drones are also used for search and rescue operations, geographical mapping of inaccessible terrains and locations, building safety inspections, storm tracking, as well as in photography and videography. These are few applications of drones. So in this topic, we saw about the unmanned aerial vehicle in brief and also about the applications of drones. So keeping this in mind, let us now move to the next topic. Moving to the next news article, Kudumbashree to help with global placements. Look at this article. See, according to this article, the youths of Kerala are pursuing an 8-month online German language training course. After this course, they will fly to Germany to pursue their vocational graduation. This opportunity is being provided by the Kudumbashree Mission. See, Kudumbashree Mission is the nodal agency for implementing the Deen Dayal Upadhyaya Grameen Kaushalya Yojana. So in this context, let us learn about the Kudumbashree Mission and the scheme Deen Dayal Upadhyaya Grameen Kaushalya Yojana. See, Kudumbashree is the poverty eradication and women empowerment program implemented by the State Poverty Eradication Mission of the Government of Kerala. The name Kudumbashree in Malayalam language means prosperity of the family. When we say the word Kudumbashree, it actually means two entities. This name represents Kudumbashree Mission as well as the Kudumbashree Community Network. Know that Kudumbashree was set up in the year 1997 following the recommendation of a 3-member task force appointed by the state government. Know that it has a 3-tier structure for its community network. 1. It has neighborhood group at the lowest level. 2. It has the area development societies at the middle level. 3. It has a community development societies at the local government level. Know that the Kudumbashree community network was extended to cover the entire state of Kerala in 3 phases during the year of 2000 to 2002. By March of the year 2015, Kudumbashree Community Network had nearly 260,000 neighborhood groups and about 20,000 area development society and 1,072 community development societies with a total membership of around 41 lakh women. See, Kudumbashree membership is open to all adult women but limited to 1 membership per family. Also, in the year 2011, the Ministry of Rural Development, Government of India, recognized Kudumbashree as a state rural livelihood mission under the National Rural Livelihood Mission. So these are few important points regarding Kudumbashree. Now let us see about the scheme Deen Dayal Upadhyaya Grameen Kaushalya Yojana. See, this scheme is an important government scheme that focuses on rural development in India. It is a centrally sponsored scheme announced in the year 2014. Also note that it is a part of National Rural Livelihood Mission. Its two major objectives are incorporating diversity to the income of rural poor families and also to cater to the career aspirations of rural youth. Also, the focus of the scheme is on rural poor youth between the age group of 15 and 35. This scheme, it can also be said that it is a demand-driven skills training program that alongside this provides placement opportunities to the rural poor youths. In addition to it, it supports the social and economic programs of the government such as Digital India, Make in India, Smart Cities, Startup India and Stand Up India as a part of Skill India campaign. See, the youth from rural India face several hurdles in their pursuit of a better life in the form of lack of formal education and required scheme. The Deen Dayal Upadhyay Grameen Kaushalya Yojana seeks to bridge this gap by funding training projects that are of global standards with a focus on placements, retention, career progression and placements opportunities in abroad. Importantly, know that this scheme is under the Ministry of Rural Development, Government of India. So in this topic, we dealt with the Kudumbashri mission, also about facts related to Kudumbashri community network. Besides this, we also saw about the Deen Dayal Upadhyay Grameen Kaushalya Yojana scheme. So with this, we have come to the end of this topic discussion. Now let us move to the next topic. Moving to the next news article, new population policy keeps all sections in mind, says Uttar Pradesh Chief Minister Adityanath. This article is regarding the recently launched Uttar Pradesh population policy for the year 2021 to 2030. As we know, Uttar Pradesh with more than 24 crore residents is the most populous state in India. As per the Niti Aayog data, the total fertility rate in the state of Uttar Pradesh was 3.1 in the year 2016. This is considered to be the highest in the country, where the national average of total fertility rate was 2.3. We all know that uncontrolled rise in population can be an obstacle to the development. It is also one of the leading causes of major problems and prevailing inequality in society. For example, as per the Crimes in India report released by the National Crime Records Bureau, the state of Uttar Pradesh topped the list in crimes against women. Now let us see the policy objectives. The new population policy aims to decrease the total fertility rate from 2.7 to 2.1 by 2026 and ultimately to 1.7 by the year of 2030. In addition, it focuses on increasing modern contraceptive prevalence rate from 31.7% to 45% by the year 2026 and to achieve 52% by 2030. Another aim is to decrease maternal mortality rate from 197 to 150 and then to 98 by the year of 2030. Also, this new population policy focuses on reducing infant mortality rate from 43 at present to 22 by the year 2030. The policy also proposes some stringent measures to achieve these objectives. It proposes to bar people with more than two children from contesting local body elections, applying for government jobs and receiving any kind of government subsidies. It also proposes to prohibit promotions in government jobs for people with more than two children and to offer incentives to those with up to two children. Till now, we saw about the new population policy. Now, let us discuss in brief about India's population policy. See, India evolved a comprehensive national population policy in the year 1967. The primary assumption was that the population explosion was an offshoot of poverty. Then came the 1976 national population policy. This policy proposed to increase the marriage age from 15 to 18 years for girls and from 18 to 21 years for boys. Based on this, the population figures of 1971 are frozen till 2026 for the purpose of delimitation. Another major development was the national population policy in the year 2000. According to this policy, the major objective was to address the unmet needs for contraception, healthcare infrastructure and health personnel. In addition, it also provides integrated service delivery for basic reproductive and child health care. Know that the medium-term objective of the National Population Policy 2000 was to bring the total fertility rate to replacement levels by 2010, This was through vigorous implementation of intersectoral operational strategies. The long-term objective is to achieve a stable population by the year of 2045. This will be at a level consistent with the requirement of sustainable economic growth, social development, and environmental protection. See, some of the outcomes of this policy are: total fertility rate declined from 2.9 in 2005 to 2.2 in the year 2017. Secondly, out of 37 states or union territories at that time, 25 states and union territories have already achieved the replacement level fertility of 2.1 or less. And the decadal growth rate has declined from 21.54% in the year 1999 to 2000 to 17.64 during the period of 2001 to 2011. So these are few facts that are related to the outcomes that India witnessed after the implementation of National Population Policy 2000. With this, we have come to the end of this topic discussion. So in this topic, we saw about the National Population Policy, how it evolved over the years, and also about the new population policy that was framed by the government of Uttar Pradesh. So keeping this in mind, now let us move to the next news article discussion. Look at this news article. It says Telangana government will be borrowing rupees 6,000 crore using the open market operations after the state's borrowing limited has been raised by the union government. Let's have a little foreground on this. See, state finances have come under strain as they fight the pandemic amid shrinking revenues. Earlier, before the pandemic, the states can borrow up to 3% of their state GDP from the market. But now, the limit has been raised by 2% of state GDP. So, as you can see, a state with better GDP can borrow more in actual value. See, the rise is not going to be available easy for the states. The part of the borrowing will be linked to specified reforms, including recommendations by the 15th Finance Commission. Let us discuss more about it. See, the 200 basic points or the 2% increase in borrowing limit is linked to specific reforms as mentioned earlier. The first 0.5% will be unconditional, whereas the next 1% will be divided into 4 tranches of 0.25% each. Each segment of fund is linked to clearly specified, measurable and feasible reform actions. These include reforms in 4 areas. Let us see it one by one. Firstly, the reforms related to universalization of one nation, one ration card. 2. Ease of doing business. 3. Reforms related to power distribution. 4. Reforms related to urban local body revenues. The last 0.5% of the extra borrowing will be allowed if milestones are achieved in at least 3 out of 4 reform areas. So using that leeway, Telangana is borrowing more through open market operations. Let us quickly discuss about this open market operation. See, open market operation is any purchases and sales of government securities and sometimes even commercial papers. See, this is done by the Central Banking Authority, which is the Reserve Bank of India. By buying or selling bonds, bills and other financial instruments in the open market, a central bank can expand or contract the amount of reserves in the banking system. So ultimately, this can influence the country's money supply. For understanding, hypothetically assume that RBI is selling bonds. When the central bank sells such instrument, it absorbs money from the system. That is, when the sale is made by the RBI takes money from the bank in exchange for government security. So the money available with the general public is absorbed by the central bank. Conversely, when the RBI buys the government securities, it injects money into the system. This method of trading in the market to control the money supply is called as open market operation. That is all about this news article. So in this news article, we saw about the open market operation as well as about the borrowing limits for states and the reforms linked with it. With this, we have come to the end of this topic discussion. Now let us move to the next topic. Coming to the last news article for today's discussion, NIA raids 7 locations in Kashmir, seizes digital devices. The news article mentions that the National Investigation Agency has raided multiple locations in Kashmir Valley. This was done while dealing with a case regarding online radicalization by the Islamic State of Iraq and Syria, in short ISIS, in India. See, radicalization is a phased and a complex process in which an individual or a group embraces a radical ideology or belief. Such ideology or belief accepts, uses violence, including the acts of terrorism, and these are done to reach a specific political purpose or ideological purpose. So simply, radicalization is the process by which an individual or group adopts extreme political, social or religious views. And here, people sometimes self-radicalize by reading or listening to extremist literature or speakers. But most commonly, what happens is there may be an individual or group which actively seeks to persuade others to adopt their extremist views. And that is why this process of persuasion or coercion is also known as radicalization. This is what has been done by the ISIS for many years by using cyberspace. So what is the result of such radicalization? See, innocent people, especially youths, are brainwashed by the terrorists and extremist organizations to join and support them. In simple words, terrorists or extremist organizations recruit the easily influenced individuals through radicalization. Ultimately, people believe this and participate in terrorist groups and become terrorists. These issues have been raising and becoming a problem to India's security system. Hence, in order to counter such terror activities, India has been coming up with legal and institutional measures. One of the agencies that combats radicalization, one of the institutional agency that was formed to combat radicalization is the National Investigation Agency. Let us see about it. See, NIA is a statutory body established by the National Investigation Agency Act of 2008. It was established for the investigation and prosecution of offenses under the act specified in the schedule. These are acts in the schedule, and offenses under these acts are called scheduled offenses. The aspirants can have a glance of it. See here, radicalization would fall under the definition of unlawful activity, which is punishable under the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act 1967. Also know that it will come under Section 8, Subsection E of the schedule, that is under Section 66F of the IT Act. Note that the punishment for cyber terrorism is imprisonment, which may extend to imprisonment for life. Also note that NIA is functioning as a central counter-terrorism law enforcement agency in India. The superintendence of the agency vests with the central government. Note that the NIA is headed by a director general who is appointed by the central government. So in this news article, we saw about the definition of radicalization and the institutional structure formed by India, Indian government, that is the National Investigation Agency, and the role of central government in it. With this, we have come to the end of news article discussion session. Now let us move forward with prelims practice question session. Coming to the prelims practice question session, now let us take up this previous year prelims question. First question, India is regarded as a country with demographic dividend. This is due to option A, its high population in the age group below 15 years. Option B, its high population in the group of 15 to 64 years. Option C, its high population in the age group above 65 years. Option D, its high total population. See, we saw in our discussion that demographic dividend is the economic growth potential, which is the result from the shift in population's age structure. And this happens when the share of working age population is larger than the non-working age share of the population. And we also discussed that according to the United Nations, the working age population is between the age group of 25 to 64 years, and the non-working age population is 14 years and below, whereas the 65 years and older are also considered to be non-working age of population. So here the age group of 15 to 25 is not included in the non-working age population, and they constitute the youth, who are important section of working population. So based on this, we can arrive that demographic dividend could also include the age group of 15 to 25. This is why option B is correct, and also other options are not even near the definition of demographic dividend. Now moving to the next question, this is also previous year prelims question which deals with the demographic dividend. Let us see it. Second question, to obtain full benefits of demographic dividend, what should India do? A. Promote skill development. B. Introducing more social security schemes. C. Reducing infant mortality rate. D. Privatization of higher education. Now let us take up the second statement. C. The social security schemes can be used for providing security to non-working population like old age pension schemes, etc. Therefore, it will not help the working age population at that time. Therefore, it will not provide any benefit of demographic dividend. So, you can eliminate option B. Now, moving to option C, infants are not part of demographic dividend and therefore it should not provide any benefit of demographic dividend. Eliminate option C. Now, come to option D. It says privatization of higher education. This is incorrect because it can have negative effect on youth population as it will make education costlier and making education out of reach of a larger section of eligible population. Hence, the answer for this question is option A, promoting skill development. Moving to the third question, consider the following statements. Statement 1, Kudumbashree is the poverty eradication and women empowerment program implemented by the state of Karnataka. Statement 2, Deen Dayal Upadhyay Grameen Kaushalya Yojana is a centrally sponsored scheme focused on rural development in India. Which of the statements given above is sir or correct? The options given are option A, one only, option B, two only, option C, both one and two, option D, neither one nor two. Now let us take up the first statement. It says Kudumbashree is the poverty eradication and women empowerment program. Yes, this part of the statement is correct. But it also says it is implemented by the state of Karnataka. See, in our discussion, we saw that Kudumbashree is a poverty eradication and women empowerment program, which is regarded as a state poverty eradication mission of the government of Kerala. So, the first statement is incorrect. Now, moving to second statement. It says the Deen Dayal Upadhyay Grameen Kaushalya Yojana is a centrally sponsored scheme which focuses on rural development in India. Yes, this is the correct statement, where we also saw that Deen Dayal Upadhyay Grameen Kaushalya Yojana is a part of National Rural Livelihood Mission and it is a centrally sponsored scheme. So, the second statement is correct. Hence, the correct answer for this question is option B, 2 only. Now, moving to the fourth question, consider the following statements regarding open market operation. Statement 1, open market operations involve definite increase of money supply only. Statement 2, open market operation is carried out by the Reserve Bank of India. Which of the above statements are correct? Options given are option A, one only, option B, two only, option C, both one and two, option D, neither one nor two. See, from our discussion, we can conclude that the open market operation is exclusively performed by the Reserve Bank of India, which buys and sells security from the market. Accordingly, open market operation can either increase or decrease the money supply in economy. So, this first statement is wrong because it says that open market operation involves increase of money supply only. Now, moving to statement 2, this statement is correct because open market operation is carried out by RBI only on behalf of the government. So, the answer for this question is option B, 2 only. Now, moving to the last question for today's discussion. The National Investigation Agency Amendment Act 2019 expanded the jurisdiction of NIA Act 2008 to include persons who commit a scheduled offence beyond India against the Indian citizens or affecting the interest of India. Which of the following are a scheduled offences under the Act? 1. Counterfeiting currency notes. 2. Sedition. 3. Cyber terrorism. 4. Track of persons. Select the correct answer using the code given below. The options given are option A, 1 and 2 only, option B, 1 and 3 only, option C, 2 and 3 only, option D, 1, 2, 3 and 4. This is a direct factual based question. The correct answer for this question is option D, 1, 2, 3 and 4. Let us see how. See, scheduled offences means an offence specified in the schedule of the act. First option is correct because the schedule includes the offences under section 489A to 489E of the IPC. Here, the section 489A to E deals with counterfeiting currency notes or bank notes. As you know, sedition is covered under the section 124A of IPC. And as per the schedule of NIA Act, offences under the chapter 6 of IPC includes section 121 to 130. So, section 124 is also included in it. While considering the third one, the cyber terrorism, it is covered in the IT Act under section 66F. It is also included in the schedule. Finally, the trafficking of persons is also a scheduled offence and is listed in the schedule under section 370 and 370A of the IPC. So, the answer for this question is option D, 1, 2, 3 and 4. These are few mains questions for which the aspirants can write the answers and post this in the comment section for peer review. With this, we have come to the end of today's news analysis session. If you like this session, kindly press the like button, share it and subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy for further updates. Thank you.